Hello and welcome, everybody. Grab a seat. It's good to see you. My name is Jeff Kushkiri. If I haven't met you, it'd be great to hang around after the service and to get to know you. So if you're new, a special welcome. If you're on live stream, a special welcome. If you're here in person, a special welcome. There's a lot of special welcomes happening today, isn't there? And we've got a guest speaker coming up, so I won't spoil that. You'll be on the edge of your seats waiting to hear who that is. Let me have a look at God's word to start off. Psalm 92 from verse 12 to 15. It says, "The righteous will flourish like a palm tree. They will grow like the cedar of Lebanon. Planted in the house of the Lord, they will flourish in the courts of the Lord. They will still bear fruit in old age." Wow. "They will stay fresh and green, proclaiming, 'The Lord is upright. He is my rock. And there is no wickedness in him.'" Wow, that's what we want for everybody here, whether they're young or whether they're old or in between. We want them to be flourishing. We want them to be serving the Lord, trusting the Lord, living for the Lord. And that's what we want, don't we? We want them obeying, worshipping, praising God. And that's what we're going to do now in a song. It's called "The Love of the Father." Let's praise God in song.
Lift up your voices, lift up your praise, join with the heavens. from darkness and into the light. The sons and the daughters of love that have priced our God has made us His forever.
Bye. my side. His hope, his strength, his peace is mine. The Lord is by my side.
Right, have a seat, everybody. We're just going to give you some church news, some family news. We've got our church family meeting coming up. It's on the 11:30 Sunday, the 10th of September. We've got it up there. Beautiful. So we'll be updating each other on the finances, what's happening with the property. There are new members. There's some new members starting, which will be great. But also, we're going to be praying a lot. Normally, we have the first Sunday of the month to pray one-on-one together. But this will be a special time in the church family meeting where we'll pray for all our concerns and our dreams, which will be great. The next announcement here is the National Grandparents Conference. It starts at 9 a.m., it goes all day, up on the 16th of September. It's a great day when grandparents, and I think quite, if you put up, who's the grandparents here? Let's see.
Great-grandparents.
Oh, great-grandparents. Okay, what about great-great-grandparents? Anybody out there? No. No, this is fantastic. And what we want to be doing is leaving a spiritual legacy to our grandchildren and great-grandchildren, okay? And so there's going to be some great speakers at this conference to be encouraging us. They're grandparents, and they're going to be encouraging us to get to our children to know about Jesus, to trust Jesus, to live for him, and to worship him, which will be fantastic. All this has only happened for $30. Yes, I'll say it again, $30. It gives you morning tea, lunch, afternoon tea, and a ticket to the conference as well. And we'll be a hub here, and so we'll all be coming here, and some other churches will be as well, to actually have live stream here, and it'll be discussions and everything. So it'll be great. So please come along to that. Ian and Rhonda is going to be talking about that a little bit later as well, so you'll get a little bit more of a snippet of what that is about, which is, it's exciting and fantastic idea. Okay, let's have a look now. Is Twists and Turns. This is for other people's grandchildren that haven't got Christian parents, basically. And so we invite them from the schools, from Scripture, to come to a holiday kids program. And it's great. They hear about Jesus. And then some of those children say, I want to come to church. And they bring their parents to church. And then we've seen them become Christians as well, the parents and the grandchildren. So this is great to do. So it's on the first week of the holidays, the third holidays here. And it's from kindergarten to year six, the program will be. And what we need is, we need assistance. So if you can do morning tea, it'd be great to have you. If you can do registrations, once again, great to have you. If you can do crafts, that would be good to have you as well. And so as a team, we'll work together to beautifully get the message of love across to them in word and deed. So see me or Nicola about that. That would be great. Also, so Mike's away, as you know. He's away for three Sundays, yep. So that would be good. And we'll have a few different speakers in that time. He's coming back on 9/11. Sounds dangerous, doesn't it? That's American time, 9/11. It's the 11th of the 9th, okay? But we're sure he's flying in a plane, but we'll know he'll land safely and all that sort of stuff, because we need him back here. That's good. And Marion as well. Okay, let's have a look. Oh, the offering box is at the back. So if you class yourself as a member of this church, the way we support the church and the kingdom here is we give. So there's physically you can give in the offering boxes, or via Vi. She doesn't collect all the money, but if you want to give online, she can link you up and things like that. So there's two ways to give so our kingdom can grow in this particular area of the world. Now, let's have a look at these guys here. So Ian's coming up, and Rhonda Barnett. It's great to have you guys. So Ian was the minister, senior minister of Fig Tree Anglican Church. Rhonda's his wife. And Ian, just before he retired, well, the last few years, he didn't think he had enough work on as a senior minister. And he started, this is his heart for the Lord, he started this movement. It's called the National Grandparents Movement. And so then after he retired, he kept on with it, which is good. And both, he probably dragged you in too, Rhonda, did he? Is that how it works?
Just a little bit.
They said, behind every great man is a wife rolling her eyes. Well, no, no. No, behind every great man, there's a woman working together to support. That's what my wife says. I don't know. Okay, let's get to know you guys a little bit more. So, Rhonda, can you... I thought you might know about the family a bit more. No, no, I'm sure Ian does as well. So, tell us about your family. How long you've been married to this guy for and all that sort of stuff?
Okay, so we've been married for over 42 years.
Wow.
We have three adult children, two sons and a daughter. So we have Luke, James and Emma, all married. And we have seven grandchildren.
Wow. And how old is the youngest one?
The youngest is four.
Okay, now Ian, how old is the oldest one?
16.
Oh, he was good, he was good. I was trying to catch him out. No, that's all.
He's good.
Okay. Now, Ian, I'll ask you, what have we got? Ian, what's your heart for those grandchildren? You've got seven grandchildren. What's your heart?
Specifically, they know Jesus. I want them in heaven with me and Rhonda. And I also want them to understand that being a Christian and knowing Jesus, even in 2023, should be normal. They don't have to be embarrassed or feel awkward with their friends if they go to church, go to a kids' club or something like that. And so, but primarily, I want them to know the Jesus that we've known for such a long time so that they too will have that hope of heaven. So, yeah.
That's beautiful. That's excellent. And Rhonda, how do you do that? Does that just happen by magic or how do you do it? Are you intentional or what?
Prayer, first of all. Mm. and that's my passion, is prayer. Always has been. But I think just in our daily walk, our daily conversations with everything that we do with the children, even when I looked after the babies, I looked after my daughter's two little ones, just being out in nature, God was there. And even from infants, I was teaching them who is our creator and what a marvellous artist he is, the colours in our birds and everything. So just the very simplest things to greater things in life. Yeah, challenges, and always also concern for their parents and prayerfully asking God to help them parent our grandchildren well.
Lovely. So. No, thank you, Rhonda. Excellent. What about Ian? What's your vision for the National Grandparents Movement? What's your vision and how do you hope to achieve that under God?
Yeah, look, when I started in 2017, I had no idea what I was doing. Just be very clear about that. And yet God stirred our hearts to do something in terms of passing on legacy. One of our goals is to reach 30,000 grandparents so they can be intentional in sharing their faith with their grandkids. We do that with our annual conference, which I'm so excited that you're going to stream here. We do that providing seminars to different churches and groups about some things you can learn about being a grandparent. Unlike you guys, I don't know everything about being a grandparent. I've got so much to learn. And thirdly, by providing resources. So for the first time, there's actually a new book going to be launched in September on grandparenting in our Australian context. Most of the stuff that I found, when I thought about retirement and I tried to find out some resources about what it's like to be retired as a Christian grandparent, all I could find was things about superannuation, being a grey nomad, taking holidays, playing golf. I couldn't find anything that spoke to me directly about being a grandfather or a grandmother. So, lo and behold, I'd reached out to YouthWorks and a new book is being launched with a whole range of different chapters about being grandparents. So, there are a couple of key things just to encourage people and equip them in their role as grandparents.
Wow, that's great. Looking forward to that book. That's good. Hey, Rhonda, what would you say is some prayer points for the national movement and things like that? Yeah.
Where do I start?
There's a lot.
I suppose resources, people resources, people with gifts and abilities that can contribute to help it go further. Financial's always helpful. Everything costs. Yeah, and just people willing to be involved, and like your church, having other churches invited in, that's a really wonderful thing. That's being willing to be open to others as well, to come and watch it together, encourage each other together. What else is there?
No, they're key. Just continue to ask that God keeps opening up doors for us that really surprise us. We never thought we'd be this far in terms of what we're doing in regards to grandparents. To have a chance to connect with Billy Graham's daughter, Anne Graham Watts, was a thrill for us. And a whole range of other people who are keen in this last quarter of our lives to still impact those around us. And so it's just amazing what God keeps doing. So, yeah. Pray for opportunities.
That's great. No, we'll do that. Now, you're looking nice and slick there, Ian. So I'm going to put you on the spot and say, if you're going to do an announcement, the best announcement for the National Grandparents Conference, I'll hand it over to you. What? Go for it. You persuade all these people. So they all put up their hand, and at the end, I want them all to put up their hand and say, no, I'm going to that conference as well.
Jeff, you're doing such a good job, you should do it. I'll just stand back. The best thing, let's take a risk and take a step for Jesus and join the only conference on grandparenting in Australia. Woo. Full stop. And be mad not to. It's now part of a global movement. So you've been joining people in America, Albania, Dominican Republic, Africa, who are all now launching grandparent ministries. So why not take a step, a risk, and learn something new and join Jeff and the team here on the 16th of September. Thank you, Jeff.
Sounds great. That was excellent. Yeah. Have a seat. Thank you for coming, guys. Yeah. Woo. Let me pray to that end. Dear Heavenly Father, we pray for resources for this great ministry, Lord. We pray for people resources, wise people to be stepping up to writing material. Thank you for that book that's going to be written, especially for grandparents and Christian grandparents, Lord. Pray for financial resources as well, Lord. Pray for other churches to get involved, to either combine and use their facilities so people can spur each other on to love and good deeds as they look towards their grandchildren, and pray for them, speak to them, intentionally live their life with them every day, sharing the highs and lows and showing how Jesus is a part of their life, and that you can be a part of their life too, Jesus, the young ones in our amongst us, Lord. We pray all these mighty things for Jesus' name. Amen. So, we're about to sing, and it's going to be "To Thine Be the Glory." That's what we want for the little ones. We want them to be saying, yeah, to you be the glory. Out of the mouths of babes, we've got wisdom coming. And so they can even show us. So let's sing this song, "To Thine Be the Glory, God."
Conquering sun, endless is the victory thou, O death, hast won. Angels in bright raiment rolled the stone away, kept the folded grave closed where thy body lay. Thine be the glory, risen conquering sun, endless is the victory thou, O death, hast won. Thank you.
Thank you for those four that are serving us by loving and teaching our children. That's wonderful. Now, we'll turn to a time of prayer. And I looked at Psalm 92, which Ian will be referring to in the sermon a bit, and I'm praying in line with Psalm 92. It says, "Gracious Creator, in the stillness of this moment, we come before you with hearts full of gratitude. Just as the psalmist proclaims the greatness of your works, we too marvel at your wisdom and your power that has been shaped in the world and shaped the world and us. As the palm tree stands tall and firm, rooted in your love, we seek to be steadfast in our faithfulness to you and trust in you. Like the cedar of Lebanon, may we live and be a testament to your righteousness and your grace. In the beauty of every day, we find reasons to sing joyful songs and be thankful to you. Your steadfast love is a refuge to us, and your faithfulness sustains us through every season of life. As we reflect on the past, we look ahead to the future. May we continue to grow in your presence, flourishing like the flourishing of a righteous person. Guide us to use our talents to your glory, that our lives may be sweet melody and a praise of beautiful songs to you. In times of challenging, help us to remember that you are our rock and you're our salvation. You're our fortress in whom we can find strength. May the meditations of our heart and the words of our mouth be pleasing in your sight as we look and offer prayers and supplications to you. We thank you for the fellowship of believers and the privilege of gathering together here in your name. As we continue to walk in your light, may our lives shine as beacons of hope to those around us. In all these things, we declare that your goodness and your power is boundless and endless." Dear Lord, we now turn to Margaret Case, who is going to be moving into a nursing home soon. Please help her and Ray as they move Margaret into the nursing home. Pray her to settle in well and feel comfortable there. We pray for Marion Lau, who just underwent an operation. We pray that she'll have a speedy recovery, Lord, and be fully recovered soon, Lord. We pray for those doing Christianity Explored with me on Sunday afternoons, that they'll come to know Jesus in a deep, true sense, Lord. And we pray for John and Elizabeth with their ongoing struggles with health. We pray that you'll be with them and that we'll be with them and support them. We pray for Sharon Whitfield and their family as they're grieving. They're grieving Sharon's aunt's passing. And we pray for the funeral next week, Lord. And we pray for preparation for the kids' holiday program, that that will go well, Lord. We pray these things in your son's name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, now we're going to have a Bible reading by Sue. And after that Bible reading, Ian's going to come and preach to us. Thanks. On legacy.
Good morning, everyone. So the reading today is from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 7 to 18. "But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that all this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. For we who are alive are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that his life may also be revealed in our mortal body. So then, death is at work in us, but life is at work in you. It is written, I believed, therefore I have spoken. Since we have the same spirit of faith, we also believe and therefore speak, because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead will also raise us with Jesus and present us with you to himself. All this is for your benefit, so that the grace that is reaching more and more people may cause thanksgiving to overflow to the glory of God. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Here ends the reading.
Well, it's great to be with you today. Pastor Mike has been very kind in inviting me along, and Jeff and the team have been very welcoming. So it's a thrill to be here. I'm 67, and of course I'm married to a very young bride, Rhonda. She's only 66, so it's fantastic. And you should know, and you've been so kind, even though I'm an Anglican, I did marry a Baptist. So that straightens me out. And so that's fantastic. So Rhonda's kept me on the straight and narrow for many, many years. And it's just so good to be part of a church that is so keen to think about grandparenting and what that might mean, and especially when it comes to passing on a legacy. And so my talk is entitled today, Footsteps for Future Generations, and you'll see PowerPoints pop up as well, which is great. And look, no matter what you hear me say today, no matter how I say it, no matter what touches you, understand this, we're all leaving a legacy. It's great. I can just see a friendly pastor down there. Fancy seeing you here, Jeff. And so we're all doing that. We're all leaving a legacy. We get a chance now to determine what that legacy is, and that's what I want to encourage you with today. And so here's this question I've been wrestling with probably for quite a few years now, in particular since 2017. What is the legacy I'm leaving behind for my family, my grandkids to follow? And in particular, what is it when it comes to my faith in Jesus? How am I trying to influence or encouraging them to pick up something that really, really matters, that's determined our walk with God for over 40 years now? And yes, we know legacy comes in all shapes and sizes. We all leave things behind. I think when our children, especially our children, when they think of legacy, they think more of the material things. You know, mum and dad, you're not looking too well. When are you dying? Can we get the inheritance now? We need to buy a home. All those things. Yes, I know that's true. But when I think of legacy, I think of much more than that, because things of this world do not last. But faith in Jesus Christ does, and it has an eternal impact, like some of the songs we've been singing today, which we need to be mindful of. Now, I know the generation that follow us will know far more than we ever will or ever did. And to be truthful, I probably can think of that song by Louis Armstrong back in 1967, What a Wonderful World. Some of you might quickly go there. I hear babies cry, I watch them grow, they'll learn much more than I'll ever know, which is true. That's true in this generation. So as we think about legacy, let me pray for God's help. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can gather together. Lord, stir our hearts to think about who we are, the journey we are on, and indeed the legacy we can leave for others to follow. In Jesus' name, amen. Last month in July, my son-in-law Ben, there's a photo of him on the screen, he ran the Gold Coast Marathon. That's Ben in the blue shirt with the cap on. We went up there, Rhonda and I, and our daughter Emma and grandkids, and we watched Ben run 42.2 k's. I'm thinking, that's a long race. I still do a little bit of running, but the marathon is pretty powerful. Rob DiCostello, the famous Australian runner, as at the start of the marathon race, in his pep talk to build them up, said this: don't forget that the first 30 k's is just the warm-up. The race doesn't start till the 31st kilometre run. And I'm thinking, well, we were at the 31k mark for Ben. He looked pretty tired by then. However, when I heard that, it really did connect with me about the Christian life. The first 30 Ks, the first 60 years, brothers and sisters, is just the warm-up. My belief is now we're in this, I called it earlier in the interview, the final chapter, we're in the most influential period of our life when all the things we've learned and heard now come to bear. Because I know what comes next in my life. I know what I'm looking for in the next step I take. It's not as if I'm going to live forever. And so now we're living in that most influential and particular pointed time of our life. Hebrews 12 says this, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance. And in life, you need perseverance. And when I talk about grandparents, I'm also talking about people who have a grandparent type influence. You don't have to be married, you don't have to have grandkids. I've noticed people, and Rhonda's seen this in many churches, they have what I call a grandparent influence. They've made the decision to help out with kids ministry, even if they're 70 or 80. And so you don't have to have grandkids to have a grandparent type influence. So I want to encourage you in that way. And so as we think about this, it is a marathon we're in, this race we're running. How are we going? Can you really understand that maybe we came to faith in our 20s, so it seems like a long time ago now. But what if these years and these days we're living are the ones that really will determine the future of our kids and grandkids? I also am very mindful that many people who have children are not walking with the Lord. I'm very mindful that they've walked away, even though you might have sent them to Sunday school and all those things back in the day. But now grandkids, and more, the research indicates that more and more parents have access to grandkids, either because of cost of living crisis, mum and dad are working, and so we become, as we know, the taxi drivers of taking them to the gym or swimming and all those things as well. So they're with us, they're in the car, we can influence, we can connect. So let's think about, so what's this legacy we're talking about? Here's the definition on the screen. The definition of legacy is something that is passed on. But legacy can take many forms. A legacy may be of one's faith, ethics, and core values. A legacy may be monetary or your assets. A legacy may come from one's character, reputation, the life you lead, setting an example for others and to guide their future. So I want to talk to you about leaving a legacy that will outlive you, that will go beyond you. And as a pastor, I've done far too many funerals, just let you know that. And I've sat there and listened to people talk about the one who's passed on. I don't often hear grandkids talk about, well, granddad or grandma. One thing that stands out, they love Jesus. And I want to make sure that as we influence others, they can actually say that about us. And it's not so much, again, things of this world, but what are we doing with the faith we have? The legacy we'd have, and that's what we want to talk about today. A legacy about courageous grandparents who know what comes next, and yet they are still firm in their faith in Christ through all the ups and downs of life. And that reading we had from 2 Corinthians was read to us so wonderfully. Those words, do I quote them? We're wasting away. We know how our bodies change as we get older. I wonder how many of you now, you know, having a fish oil each day, krill oil, you know, glucosamines, you know, osteopanadol. You know, we get up each day and to even move, we've got to go to the kitchen first to get a bottle of pills, let alone the arthritis cream, the Voltaren, all the rest that we need to keep us moving. We know that physically, but inwardly, we're being renewed day by day. Is that true for you? Is that true for me? You see, footsteps leave an imprint. That's the key. Footsteps leave an imprint. And what might they be for you? I know if we thought of Anzacs or even the Queen who passed away recently, we'd think of words like sacrifice, commitment, courage. All those things are true when we think of them. Well, what about us? You see, grandparents, I've noticed, are more of a constant in kids' lives, even if they don't live close to you, because we know in this world our kids and families live all over the place. But you can be in their space through the wonders of technology, etc., and through prayer. Grandparents often are the ones who can connect with grandkids even more so than their parents. Sometimes, and those watching online, sometimes our grandkids, especially through teenage years, may not want to share stuff with their parents. Or in fact, often the phrase is, you know, we have something so in common with our grandkids because we have the same common enemy, which is the parents. just you know. And Rhonda and I have learnt over the years, and I've got to say this right up front, grandparents are number two in the chain of command. We are not number one. You've got to know that. As much as we want to step in and say something and do something and strangle, no, we won't do that. We're number two, and so we must honour that and pray for our kids and pray for the in-laws and pray for the daughter-in-laws and son-in-laws, because they're the ones who are the primary influences. We're number two. Just lock that in your head. Because we know what it's like, you know, the late-night phone calls. Can you do this? Can you pick me up here? The car's broken down. Can you help out here? Can you give me some money to pay? All those things, we know it's true. And sometimes, I know as we get older, the old saying might be, we actually need a Bex. Remember that phrase, need a Bex? You know, we got rid of Bex. A cup of tea and a good lie down. You know, oh, can you get rid of the grandkids now? I just, it's so hard. And you sit in the chair and within 5 minutes, what happens? You're asleep. We know that reality. But no matter what, we are in the most influential time of our lives. And so footsteps will point the way. And here's where I want to jump into the Word of God, because this life we live in this world, there was a capitalist known as Malcolm Forbes. He used the phrase, "He who dies with the most toys wins." I do not believe that at all. He who dies with the most toys wins. No. Greed is tied in with that. And I understand life is tough for many people. But as we think about the journey we're on, you could jump to Luke 15, the story of the dad and the two sons. And I often wonder, what was grandma and grandpa doing behind the scenes? Because as the father wrestled with what the sons did, not just one son who said, "Give it all to me now," and took off. Don't forget, the other son in Luke 15 wasn't overly happy because he stayed home. He worked hard. He got really annoyed when the brother came back, don't forget. But dad was so overjoyed. And so we all make particular decisions. And it's probably common that in 2023, more of our kids need more for assistance-wise. So what might be the Bible's view of things that help us think about life? One quick summary verse might be Matthew 22, verse 37 to 39. You know it well. Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. And the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself." I think grandkids can be included in that. Love others, be generous. That's our call for grandkids. We know they need the truth. They need to hear the truth of God's word. We know that. And sometimes we want to give them the truth and a clip over the ear. That's not helpful. I've learned as you get older, let grace guide you more. We need to be gracious in our actions, in our words, in our love. As we extend grace, they'll give a greater chance to listen to the truth. And so that's really important. We are called to love and nurture our grandkids. You could even jump to Galatians 5. You think about the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience. How are you going with patience? I think as you get older, you need more patience, because we can get frustrated, kindness, goodness, all those things. So patience is important with little ones. Husbands and wives, you know you need more patience with each other, don't you? Yes is the answer. Because all of a sudden when you retire, I'm around my wife more. I have to pray for her patience because I'm in the house more. And then she'll look at me and think, "Are you still here? What are you doing here? Can't you go and do something?" Because there's a challenge there. We need patience. We need generosity. We need unconditional love. You know, our children, our kids will make different decisions compared to what we made. Luke 15 is a great example of that unconditional love. We need to love them no matter what music they listen to, what clothes they wear, or the tears in their clothes, no matter how many tattoos they have, or how many earrings they might have. We need to love them unconditionally, because they're not going to find that sort of love in this world. But that love that can come to us through Christ is something so powerful. Empathy. We need to have, I think, what James 1 talks about, a willingness to listen. A willingness to listen. To listen to them. That's a very important thing. And kindness, of course, is really powerful in 2 Timothy chapter 1. You see, as Paul writes to Timothy, and he encourages Timothy, and he stops, and there's a moment there in 2 Timothy chapter 1 where the Apostle Paul all of a sudden reflects on who? Grandma and Ma. Grandma Lois and Eunice. And all of a sudden he looks at Timothy and says, "You know, Timothy, what I saw in them, I see in you." And I don't think on a Sunday morning that Lois' grandma was getting up and giving the grandkids a four-hour lecture on doctrine. I think Lois, the grandmother, was more than likely doing the normal things that we do. Washing up, taking to school, getting lunch ready, being there for them, giving them a hug. I think more and more what Paul is saying, I see that grace and love in them that I now see in you. And I want to encourage us to express that so others can see that. Don't forget, Proverbs 16 says, grey hair is what, can you remember? A crown of glory. I'm not there yet. Proverbs 16:3. I've got to stop using that black stuff that Rhonda gets me put in my hair. You know, it is vital, brothers and sisters, that we are involved with our grandkids. Don't underestimate the power of prayer. Don't underestimate the power of prayer. I'm sure I've read that great Baptist preacher Spurgeon. While Spurgeon would allow others to preach, he was very particular when it came to prayer because he felt that was one of the most important things to do, to actually ascend the throne of grace, which we know we can do in prayer. And it's great to hear the prayers today. And so we're going to be thinking about that. Let's think further about what are some Bible verses that might help us. Here's two. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 9. Only be careful and watch yourselves closely so that you do not forget the things your eyes have seen or let them fade from your heart as long as you live. Teach them to who? Your children and their children after them. And I love Psalm 71. What about that? Since my youth, God, you have taught me. And to this day, I declare your marvelous deeds. Even when I'm old and gray, do not forsake me, my God, until I declare your power to the next generation, your mighty acts to all who come. Are we doing that? When we get up, are we talking to others about how God has sustained us to this point in life? That even though as I approach 70, I can still remember the wonders of God in years gone by. I can still remember how God led me to my marriage and our kids and all those things. But do we talk about it? Do we say anything to anyone about this great God that we know? And I encourage you to do it, especially to the little ones. They are not hearing it from the world. And depending where your children are at, they may not even be hearing it from your own kids. And so that's why we need to be open and direct in that way. When the Bible speaks of things like the next generation, it's referring to immediate families that we have influence over. Children's children, grandchildren, and things like that. You know, I don't notice the Bible talks much about grey nomads or seniors or retirees. I don't see those words in Scripture. I see other things about our faith, about Philippians 1:6, that God will finish the good work he started in you. So he hasn't finished that work in me yet. And like you, I pray that Lord, give me another 10 years so you can complete the work you started all those years ago. You know, if it takes five, do that. But he's still working in all of us, which is powerful. And so I want to make sure that spiritual legacy of faith is passed on to others. We are still influencers. Please accept that. We are still there. We are in that, can I say it, the last 10 kilometers of our race. None of us know what tomorrow will bring. It's a bit of an arrogant thing to say, I'm going to plan the next five. I've got no idea what tomorrow brings. I'm hearing too many people. The news they get up to tomorrow morning will break our hearts. We know that. And yet we're in that last 10 kilometres of that race. And so maybe even now for you guys, you're in the most influential period of your Christian life. What are you doing with it? How are you sharing it? Maybe now you actually have even more time to pray, more time to encourage others, more time to stir each other's hearts. And let's think for a moment of the change we've experienced since the year 1959. 1959, I wonder if that year resonates with you in a particular way. Billy Graham himself came to Australia. Okay, here's a photo of Billy Graham. There's a question up there. What percentage of Australian population is estimated to have heard Billy Graham share the gospel? In 1959, Australia was a population of 9.1 million. 9.1 million. Just over 3 million people heard Billy Graham live in stadiums. A third of this nation at one point in time, in one year, heard the good news of Jesus. I often, even as I say to you now, I'm stunned. Because often then I think, what the heck happened to Australia? Because by 68 or 79, when he engaged again, we were on a path of walking away from God. Look at the 2021 census data that I have on the screen for you. 2011, Christian people nominated 61%. If I just jump to 2021, that's now dropped to people identifying down to 44%. You can see the path that's on. Look at the stats from 2021 about no religion. Look how that's gone up. So you wonder why I'm thinking, grandparents, brothers and sisters, we need to do something. We need to say something. You know, while I pray for revival and pray that God does something in my lifetime, the question could be, well, what am I doing with what I know? How am I speaking about that to others? Nelson Mandela made this comment before he passed away, and he thought about legacy. What counts in life is not the mere fact that we have lived, it is what difference we've made to the lives of others that will determine the significance of the life we've led. That's the power of a legacy. That's why it's so important to be speaking about things. And even though your grandkids might be further away, we learnt through COVID, we hate saying that word, what a weird time that was, the power of technology through FaceTime. You know, we even tried to engage dinner, so we gave our kids some money to go and buy McDonald's, and so we picked a time, Friday night, 6 o'clock, we'd all stand in front of a screen and eat food together, dinner online. It worked for about 10 minutes, and then it was a disaster, and we thought, why do we try and do that? But there are ways that you can engage even with kids who are far away. I can use, you know, ever heard of something like writing letters? There are things you can do, birthday cards. They're so expensive. However, they're so powerful. Little grandkids, we notice they love, if mum and dad say there's something in the letterbox for you, it's old school, isn't it? But all I'm saying, there are things that we can do to connect no matter where they live. And it's so important to understand it. Our teaching days haven't finished. Our teaching days have not finished. And again, we can remind them of the grace of God in our lives. You know, this world we live in, the Western culture, it's a great place. But let me just say directly to those watching online, the Western world is pretty broken, I think. It wouldn't matter whether it was political, morally, you name it. The more news I read, the worse I feel. There's nothing good out there. People have turned their backs on God and they wonder why we're in such a mess. Well, I know why we're in such a mess, because we've turned our backs against God. And, you know, what did Dorothy say to Toto? Toto, I've a feeling we're not in Kansas anymore. We are not living the golden years right now in 2023 in Australia. As good as the warm winter weather has been, which I love, if it keeps going, no doubt I'll get to a point out here, we need rain. We need some more water to come down from the skies. But things are not, life is complex. Our kids are struggling, whether it be gender issues, future issues, identity issues, the list is endless. And these are things that even our kids, our eldest son is 40, I don't remember ever discussing these things 20 or 30 years ago as my kids were going through teenage years. But now, our little one, 4 and 16, this is constantly before them, all the time. You know, the conference, Dr. Jenny Brown will be speaking about some of the issues, how we deal with that, and so I encourage you to be part of it. Thank you, Jeff. Psalm 92, we read, the righteous will flourish like a palm tree. They will grow like a cedar of Lebanon. Planted in the house of the Lord, they will flourish in the courts of our God. They will still bear fruit in old age. Let me say that again. They will still bear fruit in old age. They will stay fresh and green. Look at me, look at you. I have my camera here. You guys look so fresh and green. You're still bearing fruit in old age. That's the psalmist's promise. That's the power of that. It's not as if we hit 70 or 80 and it's like, oh, that's, well, I've done my bit. It's now for me to just walk across the road to the retirement village and be, it's all over. No, it's not. And there's a wonderful verse at the end of Deuteronomy. You know, here's Moses just about to hand it over to someone called Joshua. Deuteronomy 34. Verse 7, Deuteronomy 34, verse 7. Check it out. We read this from verse 6. He buried him in Moab in the valley of opposite Beth Peor, but to this day no one knows where his grave is. Moses, verse 7, was 120 years old when he died, yet his eyes were not weak, nor his strength gone. I'm nowhere near 120. As Moses, of all the people, had done all that, even to his latter years, he'd still had clear vision, more than likely still in his most influential season. This is the whole thing about back to 2 Corinthians. Like, even though we're wasting away, inwardly we are being renewed day by day, which can connect to Psalm 92 by saying we're going to still bear fruit and be fresh and green. We might need walkers. I might need a walking stick. My hips might be sore, and they are, because I've got arthritis in one of them. But I can still cast thoughts and pray and share thoughts and wisdom about God's righteousness, still bearing fruit. And I believe grandparents, brothers and sisters, and those who have a grandparent-type influence, we're still there engaging and connecting. There was an article last year in the Sydney Morning Herald by Julia Baird. The screen will pop up. It was called The Grandmother Hypothesis. I'm not naive enough to think that grandfathers are the key. Grandmothers, I think, from what I can see, have a far more powerful influence on grandkids. Julia Baird did an article referring to some information in America, and the evidence is out for all to see. You can check that online if you want to check it out. Is that grandparents, and especially grandmothers involved in the lives of their teenage boys, have a greater chance to influence their men, these teenage boys, to deal with mental health issues and other issues. Because there was research done for boys who didn't have any grandparents, what were they all like? And so grandmothers, maybe there's something God has put in you. Gentleness, kindness. Yes, of course men have that. But maybe it's not as evident. And I know grandmas and grandpas, we do things differently. Grandfathers will go out there and probably wrestle and fall on the ground. Isn't it interesting how it's much easier to get down? It's so hard to get back up again these days. There's something weird about that. But grandmothers, there's something that God has put in them. And there's research about that. To still bear fruit. You know, it's those words from 2 Corinthians again. Yes, we know what it's like to waste away. We know what it's like to change physically. But God has not finished with this yet. And maybe in 2023, God is saying to you that your best years are now. Not even ahead of you, now. And so let's think about that. It's a terrible story from John Newton. You don't know who John Newton, know what song you wrote? Call it out, someone. Amazing Grace, thank you. John Newton, what did John Newton say? Here's a word from John Newton. It'll pop up on the screen. He said this: I know that my Father loved me, but he did not seem to wish me to see it. That breaks my heart. Now, I know it's a different time and a different stage. But brothers and sisters, whatever you do, let them know you love them. Let them see it, feel it, let them hear it. You know, yeah, that awful joke about, you know, husbands and wives, you know, the wife complaining, you never tell me you love me. And that silly story about, well, when we got married, I said I loved you then. Do I need to keep repeating it? Any bloke out there wondering? Yes, you do. You know, actually think that we're not willing to speak about the God who's got us to this stage of life. That doesn't make sense. Yes, parents, our kids are number one. And we need to be there when they make decisions that we wouldn't make. We need to support them, give thanks to God for them. We should not give unsolicited advice. Be very careful with that. You know, because that will not be received well. If they want advice, they might ask for it, or they may not. And they might make a mistake anyhow, and you're still there with them. And especially depending whether it's your sons marrying into a different family or daughters marrying in a different family. We know it's all different. You know it's complex, but we can be there. You know, what's the one thing they need? I love that moment in Luke 10, Mary and Martha, and that's about five sermons alone. And I don't have time for five sermons because I've got about 5 minutes left. You know, that awful Martha, Martha, Lord answered, Martha, Martha. Oh, it takes energy to do what you're doing today and to get things set up. Jesus says, Martha, you are worried about so many things, but few things needed. In fact, one thing is needed. I wonder if you can remember what the one thing is. Mary has chosen what is better. And it will not be taken away from. What's the one thing? Sit at Jesus' feet. What do our grandkids need? They need the one thing. They need Jesus. They need Jesus more than ever. They need to have that hope about their future. If I'm praying they're going to be in heaven with me, I need to speak about that. My little granddaughter, Matilda, 6 years old, she was getting dress-ups with Nana's clothes, as they do. And I was walking through the wardrobe area, and just randomly, had no idea where it came from, she just said, "Oh, Granddad, are you going to die one day?" I'm too busy, let me go. "Nana, your granddaughter wants you. She wants to talk about death." And I said, "Sweetheart, yes, I will." And what happens? "I'll be with Jesus. And you too." So you can stop it. You can put a full stop everything. "I'll be with Jesus. Full stop, don't say anymore. But you too can be with Jesus. You too can know Jesus. And we can be together." And she said, "Oh, that would be good." And then she stopped and just said, "I don't want you to die." But, you know, you can cut these conversations short. And kids, you know, what's the TV show? Say the darndest things at the randomness of time. But being there and allowing them to do that is so powerful. Footsteps will declare the future. Footsteps. What does God require of us? You know, Micah 6, to act justly, love mercy and walk humbly with him. I've heard it said that our fingerprints do not fade from the lives we touch. Our fingerprints do not fade from the lives we touch. And we need to remind people that great verse from Acts 4, don't we? Salvation is found in no one else. Salvation is found in no one else under heaven or earth by which men, women can be saved. It's Jesus Christ. And so we're going to do that. I want, at my funeral, Rhonda, take a note there, at Ian's funeral, take a note. I want my grandkids to be able to say, when it comes to Granddad, heaven was in him before he was in heaven. Heaven was in him before he was in heaven. Well, they have to see that. They have to know that and feel that. Grandchildren are called, what, Proverbs 17, the crown of the aged. And I know that to be true. Let's all work hard at leaving a legacy that will outlive us. Let's be present and involved. Let's tell stories. It's okay. Tell stories of how God has gotten you through the good days and the bad days. And brothers and sisters, you've got to age with grace. Don't just tell everyone. I know you don't do this, otherwise you'll throw things at me. Just don't tell everyone about your problems and your ills and your pains and things like that. Age with grace. You know, life is tough for all of us, but age with grace. Give them an example of what it means to age with grace. And pray, and pray. Psalm 145, one generation shall commend your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. One generation, let's continue to commend the work of God. And finally, last 2 points, you know, I think my wife has taught me enough about alcohol and Baptists, so it's a bad idea, okay? However, I have a family member who's into wine, okay? Here's a picture of a grapevine. I said to this person, I said, "Why do some wines age well?" I've got no idea. I don't drink. Why do some wines age well? And why do some wines turn sour? Me thinking about grandparents, some grandparents age well and some get a bit surly, a bit sour as we get older. And he said, "Well, it's all to do with the vine." Put it up again, it's all to do with the vine. And it seems the better grape, which means the better wine, is produced by a more gnarly vine. The harder the vine has had to struggle, the tougher the vine has had to live through life, the better it ages and the better fruit it produces and the better, therefore, wine it produces. It doesn't matter how gnarly or rugged your life has been. The worse it's been, the better God can use it for his glory. But tell them. Don't hide from the tough days. Don't hide from the things that have worked or not worked. And so that's so, I think that is so true. Billy Graham said, "The great legacy one can pass to one's children and grandchildren is not money or material things, but rather a legacy of character and faith." And faith. How do you, when things don't work out, how do you speak? How do you respond? Let's remind them that indeed the grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of the Lord, Isaiah 40, stands forever. They need to know that, you know, the word of the Lord is a lamp under our feet. They need to know that. As I conclude, and again, a big thank you for letting us be here today. We'd love to talk more about what we're doing. The other Sunday, we were at a particular church, and here's a photo. Rhonda was standing in a grandparent brochure, and there was a door to go into the church, and it said main entrance. Now, for me, because I'm pretty weird, I'm looking at it now, main entrance. If anyone is closer to the main entrance of heaven, it is me, us. I'm in our final chapter. And as I saw that photo, I thought, wow. When time comes for me to take that final step, and I think the Colin Buchanan actually song indicated about taking a step. And I turn around before I walk into that main entrance of heaven. What am I thinking? I'm thinking about who's following me, my kids and my grandkids. What have I done at that last point to step over that threshold? Because once I'm there, it's done. Have I done anything before I step into that final main entrance? So I pray for you and me that as I step over, I can walk in thinking, I know who's following me. Lord, it's in your hands. I've shared and spoken about all I can. May it be that they too walk with you and have that same hope that I have. Amen. Amen. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, you are so gracious to us all. Thank you for all you've done. Lord, may it be we take our opportunities and with strength, conviction, really become intentional grandparents. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Amen.
Okay, thank you, Ian. We do want to be leaving a legacy, pointing to Jesus. There's some resources on the back table that Rhonda and Ian's got there, so you might want to catch up with them and see the resources over there. It will help you in your life as grandparents and great-grandparents. We want to be leaving a legacy, don't we, to Jesus, because there's no other name like him, no other name that can keep his promises, that is all-powerful, that's creator, compassionate, forgiving. There's no other name. Guess what song we're going to sing next? No other name. Let's go for it.
Strength to cast out fears, no other name.
Well, I know one thing about grandchildren. They love playing with castles, building castles in the sand, don't they? And you can imagine them building a nice sandcastle and you're alongside them building that sandcastle. But what happens the next day? The water comes and washes it all away. So what we want to be telling them is not putting things into this world like money or relationships. These are good things, but don't make them God things to the kids. So what you want to is tell them about the king of the castle, which is Jesus, don't we? And about his castle built on the rock. And that's the legacy that we can pass on. Because flowers will fade, things will pass away, but the word of God, the word of Jesus will last forever. And we want them to echo those words in eternity. Jesus is best. Jesus is best. Jesus is best. Jesus is best. Let's go forth and do that. Join us for morning tea and have a good chat about the things that we've learned today. Thank you.
Thank you, brother.
Hey, thank you.
Hopefully that was helpful.
I might grab your...
Yeah.
On four.
There's an endless song waiting to be sung, with the voice of every tribe, the sound of every tongue. When the bride of Christ on that day of days brings with joy unto the Lamb a multitude of praise. And like the roar of mighty seas and rolls of thunder, hear his people sing, hallelujah. Salvation in his name, then greater.